Hi everyone, welcome. It is a blistering hot day around the bay and we are absolutely sweltering here. But this video is going to be even hotter because we are going to actually continue our looking at quote unquote time, the illusion, the mirage of time. And this is all important. And it's something that we feel we just simply cannot do. It's too difficult for us, but it is not too difficult. So we will do that. We will take a look at when we say there is no time, what are we talking about here? So in the mood of repentance, with our mind relaxed, our thoughts released, letting them all go, realizing the only problem we have is a continuity problem. We don't have any other problem. We look at the issue of time in this context. We don't have a time problem. We have a continuity problem. Now, what we have done, spirit wants to be prime creator. It wants to be able to say that it created a new creation, unlike reality. Now, how is it trying to do this? We need to look at this a little more carefully than we have in the past. It's trying to change reality and say that we're not free. This new creation is not free. Reality, there's absolute freedom. Each moment is, we're free to choose whatever we want to choose in our experiencing. So what we have done or trying to do is say that we're not free. We're trying to create unfreedom, an unfree situation. Okay, now this is impossible actually, because we are still, I am not a body, I am free, I am as God created me. We cannot change the will of God, we cannot change reality, but we can imagine something, all right? So what are we doing? We're gonna look at this. We will look at this and see, recognize what we're doing. When we try to create a lack of freedom, what we do is we try to say that we have to have at least two moments that we'll work with. Duality, right? Two moments. The first moment and then the second moment, which is determined by the first moment. This is called duality. We're stuck in a dream of duality. All right, you've heard that before. This is very, very, very true. When we want to have lack of freedom, we have to say that this first moment determines what the second moment is going to be in some way. So there's a process in the first determining the second. So there has to be two moments that we think are somehow joined, and there's no real freedom. The second moment is not free of the first moment. Whereas in reality, we don't have duality. Each moment is totally free. There's no second moment that is somehow connected to the first moment. Okay, there's just one. So that we say, well, it's just only one. There's only one moment. There is not a second one connected or joined or inevitably following any moment. So this is the principle of duality that we're imagining. Now, we cannot create a lack of freedom, but we can imagine what it would be like. And we think that by imagining what it would be like, that magically this will actually cause it to be. But it doesn't. So, what do we do to try and believe that this is going to happen, that we're going to create a new creation of unfreedom, failure of freedom, lack of freedom? What we have done, and continue to do, we are trying to establish that the past determines the future. that whatever we chose in past moments is actually causing us causing the future moments to be what they are, with a lack of freedom to choose something completely different. So what we have done is we have decided to string together, as it were, moment after moment after moment after moment, and have these moments be very similar to one another, to give the impression that there's some sort of inevitable process taking place. And we have strung together so many moments, one after the other, choosing, to try to sequence the moments, that we've become so familiar with this that we can't even imagine how the next moment couldn't be something similar to the moment that came before it. We cannot even imagine. We say, I can't imagine that imagination is free. It must be sequenced similar to what came in the past, because it's always, we say, well, it's always been that way. So we lose sight. What we're hoping to do is lose sight, simply from massive repetition, choosing moments, so many trillions of moments, how many, I don't know how many moments we've chosen, trillions and trillions and trillions perhaps, that each one seems to depict very similar to the one before. So you can draw an inference that the past must be influencing the present moment. Has to be, we feel. Must be, because it so many moments it seems that way. And we want to reach a point where it just seems like that's so inevitable that the next moment will seem to be influenced by the previous moments and be very similar like that. That we said we can't imagine that it could be any other way. I can't imagine that I can imagine any differently. That's where we're getting to. I can't imagine how it would be possible to imagine any differently. But the fact is that each moment is still completely free and clear of every other moment. And the past does not determine the future at all. Excuse me. And yet we can't imagine that it could be otherwise. We say we can't imagine that it could be otherwise. So we have tried to simply outlast endlessness, as it were. Just one moment. And we think that there's no way to imagine it any differently. It has to follow from the past. And we feel if we just become so familiar with this and just take it for granted, well, the future is going to be much like the past, it's because the past determines the future, then somehow, magically, it will be so. It will actually, really be so. And the fact is, it will not be so. It will never be so. So we are in this very unhappy situation because we're banking on familiarity and just repetition, and we're so bored and we're so tired of this, because we're not created to function, you know, to try to make it seem like there's this endless sequence that's so endless that it could never be anything other than this. And then we say, well, this all had to be the way that it is because there's a process taking place and there wasn't any freedom there at all. We want to reverse reason it, reaching some point where we feel, well, everything that's come before had to be what it is in order to get where we are now. This is the belief in time. There is no such time. There is no time-space like that. The space that we're seeing is called time-space. But actually, every moment remains completely free and clear of every other moment. In no way is one moment determinant of any other moment whatsoever. So there is no such thing, such times. There is no time space, the way that we want it to be. It's not there. We're seeing. We're hoping to see something that's not there. We're imagining. Well, what if there was a lack of freedom? What would that be like? So this is all kind of imaginary, hypothetical scenario existence. And the only problem we have is a continuity problem, because we cannot imagine the next moment not being, seeming to be determined by the past. We can't even imagine that. It's, you know, it seems incomprehensible. No one even question that. Of course, that tree is next moment is going to be the tree, and everything is going to be at much like it is this moment. You see, we think that this is a certainty, a reality of the situation. We believe this is the reality, that everything is a process and nothing can go off script. But this is entirely untrue. Nothing is on any script at all, actually. There is no script at all, except our wanting to be a script, our imagining, well, what if there was a script? All we're doing is saying, what if there was a script? What if time-space really did exist? What if there was a lack of freedom? But it's always a what if there was, an imagining how that would play out. Now, Jesus tells us that this whole notion of wanting to be prime creator, this whim, was over in an instant. We picked up the idea, and then in the next instant we set it down, and we're finished. But he says that to honor our idea, we're playing it out in quote-unquote time, and say, well, what if it was possible? So we're honoring this idea by saying, well, what if it was possible, this idea? What if it was possible? How could it be possible? So by this mirage, by this delusion. By this familiarity. We're hoping that familiarity somehow trumps reality. And we're hoping that God actually finally says, you know what? I'm so tired of you not functioning the way I created you, or not, you know, refusing to let go of this delusion that, okay, I give up. I'm going to make unfreedom real. I'm going to make failure of reality real for you, so that you can be happy. Because, you know, we're hoping for that. That can never happen. If that happened, reality would instantly vanish, and that's not possible. It's not possible for God to vanquish God. So there will never be an instance where God says, okay, you win. You know, we cannot default and say, we're so used to this illusion of time, there's no way we can ever give it up. So you'll just have to accept it as real and accept that it is real. It'll never happen. That will never happen. So all we have to do is set this what if scenario down. But we're afraid to do so because we want to feel as though everything's on script. That's called the continuity problem. Now, talking about time and timelessness and all that seems to be the most difficult area of all. And I hope that we're looking at it now in a way where it's not so difficult to at least kind of grasp, like, kind of see what the situation is. Interesting. We're not aware at this gross conscious level of what's going on, because the choosing of moments happens very rapidly, very, very rapidly. I'm not sure how many times a quote-unquote second it happens. I was aware of it one time. I was looking at it, and it was so fast that, you know, your thoughts can't even keep up with it. You can't even form thoughts about it. It's so fast. But the awareness is there of how we are so rapidly choosing that everything continue on what seems to be on a script of process. We're unaware at this gross level of sensory perception. We're unaware of it. It seems to be, you know, it's like watching a movie. We don't realize there's 20, 30 frames, 26 frames, whatever, a second, actually going through a projector. Still frames through a projector. And each frame is free and clear of every other frame, actually, right? It's just a bunch of images strung together is what it really is. This world is just a bunch of images strung together. We're imaging it, imagining it, imaging it. But it's the images, the frame rate is so high. Frame rate is so high. I don't know how many. There was a time when I felt I knew how many it was. Is it 1,000? You know, 1,000 frames a second. You know, really high frame rate. Because our capacity to choose is instantaneous. And yet there are, we can choose differently any moment. So the moment is also instantaneous. And when we keep choosing over and over and over again, the, you know, to sequence it like this, it seems like, it seems almost, you know, seamless. But I was aware that there was this choosing. We still have to desire, choose what we want. So there was this rapid choosing taking place in our spirit, in our mind. That gives this illusion that all of this is inevitable, that this is reality, that all of this is simply the way reality is. It's all scripted, it's all connected. That everything has to appear the way, much like the way it does right now, in the next moment, in the next moment, in the next moment. There's these cycles of growth and decay and all this. But no, it's not true. Every moment is a choice of what we want to experience. And it may be 1,000 choices in 1 second of our time, you know, something like that. Just this 1 second, one. And maybe we may have chosen 1,000 times to keep seeing, to keep this sequence going. And our creativity is, you know, massively engaged in making it seem that there is this inevitable process taking place. We call it the life cycles, all these life cycles we've imagined. Appearances. Really, we're playing with appearances. So we have imagined all these appearances arising through all these processes that we have imagined also. All of this is our imagination. And of course, at the conscious level, this, we cannot confirm this at all. But so it does take some faith. It does take faith. It requires reason to listen and hear, intuition to verify and say yeah. And those who have woken up to this fact and realize that they are free and they cannot create unfreedom, lack of freedom, they have testified to all of this. So we have to look at it through those lenses. It doesn't do any good to demand some kind of hard empirical evidence of it, because this is a spiritual problem. Now, the remedy is to experience our freedom, and our freedom has the quality of joy or happiness, intrinsic. It's always there. The happiness, knowing that you can choose whatever you want to experience every moment. There's an intrinsic bliss, joy, happiness, love, freedom, peace in that. So that is how we feel naturally. Now we can experience that here. There's nothing at all that says that we have to change what we're experiencing, we can keep on seeing the trees, each look, everything appear much the same. We can keep doing that. The difference is that we are experiencing, we allow ourselves to experience that the unalloyed happiness of knowing our true nature, instead of imagining, well, what if we didn't? What if things were different? What if it was different? What if we really were not free? We set that down and we say, well, we are free, but for the sake of the continuity problem, we will continue to go along with the general quote-unquote script of things, appearances, arising in having a certain number of moments where they arise and they seem to be altered gradually and then subside gradually. We can go along with that. There's no reason why not. But we're no longer trying to deceive ourselves that there's any such thing as time-space. In the world, but not of it. Appearing within this what-if scenario, but not actually believing what the intent of it is. Knowing that the freedom is always present, happiness is always present. Happiness is present right now, always. But we do have the capacity to imagine, well, what if it wasn't? What if it wasn't? And so we're trying to feel the feelings of what if it wasn't? Well, what's that feeling? It's fear. It's fear or unhappiness. Truly, it's very warm today. That's great. That's great. Evaporating a lot of moisture is evaporating, and hopefully this video is evaporating a lot of concerns that we have. Now, in this world, we don't practice the language of talking about timelessness. We don't practice it. We don't think about it. We don't turn our attention there. And so again, that gives this feeling of inevitability to what we are experiencing. And inevitability is the opposite of freedom in this context. You might say it's inevitable that we will drop the notion of inevitability. That's the only way to use the term inevitable properly. It's inevitable that we will drop the notion of inevitability, meaning we'll drop the notion that the past can determine the future in any way. How did the past begin? Okay, how did duality begin? Well, we said that we imagine two moments. It has to start out dualistically, doesn't it? You cannot have a past without a future. Both arise simultaneously, concurrently. And one says, oh, I'm your past. And the other says, oh, I'm your future. That's together at the same time. And the past says, oh, I've determined what you are. And the future says, oh, you have determined what I am. So this one says, I have determined what you are. This one says, you have determined what I am. Past and future. And then we take this dualisticness as a present conclusion that this is so. But we don't have to take it that this is so. We can see the trick of duality. If there was just the past, we call it the past, and there was no future, how could the past say this determine anything? So how could it be the past? Or if there's just a future, how could the future say something else determined it? where's the past to determine it? So this whole notion of imagining that a lack of freedom, where moments determine other moments, requires at its outset imagining two moments. So we're just evaporating some of the concerns here. Just recognizing these various aspects to timelessness, which seems to be the great stumbling block for everyone here. It is the great stumbling block. And it certainly has been for me as well. And Jesus says, it's the grandest of all illusions upon which all other illusions rest, really. It is a numero uno. And we are... We have a very difficult time focusing on it. When we do focus on it, we find out, hey, we can make some progress. We can see. As long as we don't struggle, we should not be struggling. So I'm trying to not struggle and just let, you know, just pace the situation. Like we're going up a very steep hill. Sometimes we stop and take a breather. You know, seems to be a very steep hill. So when we're looking at the two moments, we must make sure we don't get caught up in argumentation of, wait a minute, which is right, which is wrong, which one of these two? No, it's a concurrent arising of two moments. It's like that. And this is, I'm the past, I'm the future, you're the past, whatever. And we, you know, I'm affecting you, I'm being affected by you. But they both arise concurrently, simultaneously. But because we want to believe in this, we don't see it arising simultaneously. We see it as one moment arises, and then the next arises because by the first one arising. See, that's how we see it, like a process. We fail to see the simultaneity of the arising of our imagination of these two moments. And that's where we get caught up in argumentation, dispute, debate, and all of that. We feel like we need to determine, is it the past, you know, that's influencing the future, or is it the future being influenced by the past? You see, it's both. The idea is both. It has to be both simultaneously. So when we can see it as both simultaneously, that's when enlightenment becomes possible. When we don't give even an instant of quote-unquote time, or another moment to consider this, when we consider it right now as this dualistic arising of the imaginary influence and influencing of moments to one another. You see, we have one that's influenced the other, and we have the other that's susceptible to being influenced. So one has the power of determination, the other has the power of being influenced by the determination. See, past and future. Neither one is true. No, since no moment has the power to influence another, there can't be a past. And since no moment has the power to be influenced by another, there can't be a future. So both of these, you know, need to subside together. They arose together, they subside together as one. And don't worry about trying to get it in a linear way. We're just circling the putt, as it were. I find I always putt better if I walk all 360 degrees around the hole in the ball and just go around and just look at the whole situation, and somehow then I just get a feel, overall feel for it. Or if you just line it up behind the ball and just try to do it that way, it's not nearly as good. So what we're doing is we're just taking a walk around the whole issue of time, timelessness. Not worrying about, you know, when are we going to get it? Are we going to get it or not get it or anything like that? Just kind of getting the lay of the land. What's the slope? What's the speed? What's the break? What's this? Is this that? Okay, I gotta kind of feel for it. Get a feel for it. We're trying to get a feel for the situation, more than an analytical conclusion. Because analytical conclusions cannot give us the feel of simultaneity, of imagined to past and future. It'll oscillate, can oscillate, but it doesn't have the feel of that. And then they're subsiding together. They have to subside together, don't they? Neither the present moment has no power to influence any future moments, and any future moments we choose has no power to be influenced by any previous moment. It's not one first, the other second. It's one unit, dualistic unit, subsiding. Now, if we can do this and we can look at this, you know, we're looking at the absolute core root of the entire situation here. Calmly, without any trouble. Of course, it requires a lot of previous efforts and concentration to not struggle with it and just maintain poise with this. But still, we're doing it, so that's what's important. You see, as long as we believe that one moment determines the other, how do we set this imagination down? Because we're looking for a cause in time to set it down. There isn't any time, so there can't be any causality based on time at all. So it has to be this subsidence in the moment, the dropping, the setting it down, uncaused setting it down through realizing, recognizing that duality is one unit. It's just one moment we chose to imagine this, actually. You see, this entire scenario simply took place in one moment and then was set down. But we're imagining now, using moments to imagine that it played out through many, many moments, but it didn't. It's all in one moment. The idea of past influencing the future, future being influenced by the past moment, it all arises in one moment. And then the next moment is free and clear. Well, we can continue to imagine that in the next moment too. But that next moment is totally not determined by the previous moment. You're getting a sense of it now. I think I am a little better. And so we just give it quote unquote some moments here, some time. Not in a hurry. Just letting the wow factor kind of set in and mellow out a little bit. So the idea that one moment that moments are in influencing one another. That notion arose in one moment. Not two moments, one moment. And the next moment, we chose to have it arise again. And the next moment, again. And then therefore we concluded, if we string enough of those together, we conclude, well, it must be happening, that one moment's influencing another, because we keep on having this. But how else can we honor this notion except by repetition of choosing moments, repetition of replicating the content that came before, choosing to have it replicated for the most part, and then choosing the replication to have a lot of gradual change in it, so believing that it's happening through gradually. The new life is gradually happening. The new reality is gradually happening. No, it's all, everything that's happening is always in, totally in each moment. Now the intellect is used to getting answers, right? Supplying answers. And so in this case, it's not coming up with any clear-cut answers. So it's restless. It gets restless, which is why we have to practice the mood of repentance, so we don't get too restless. We keep ourselves seated. We don't let ourselves move around a lot. Maybe a little bit, ideally. Try not to move at all, but I tend to move a little bit. That's all right. But pretty much, you're just rooted to where you are. And you're just suffering the strain of not coming up with answers from the intellect. And this feels like that you lack an identity. It feels like that you're not sequencing properly. That you're somehow off script. And therefore, if you're off script, the whole idea of being on script is there's a process taking place that will eventuate in establishing what your true identity, your new identity. And so if you go off script, you feel like you've lost the, you don't know how to get to your new identity. But what we say is there is no new identity. And the identity that we are is always here with us. Jesus said it's nearer than nearest, the closest thing we have. Because it's right now. It's not in time. There is no time. It's always right now. And the intellect just cannot deal with this. Because the intellect wants to identify what came first and what came second. And well, chicken and egg. There is no chicken and egg. They both arose simultaneously. If you answer which came first, the chicken or the egg, that's a false question. Because that presupposes there was a first and a second, right? So when you say which came first, the chicken or the egg, you're saying that one or the other came first. And you're not been given the option of they arose simultaneously in one moment. So I'm just going slow here because I know I'm being affected by this. What I do is I kind of do my own meditation out loud so that others can get an idea of what's possible. And when they go through their own, going through your own considerations, you feel like, hey, I can do this. This is not so odd or strange or anything like that. And you're not the only one who's ruminating over these issues. It's not anything completely bizarre. No, we're just sitting here, just talking, just considering, looking, allowing the intuition to feed us information, allowing the Holy Spirit to feed us information. That we can then just look at and say, huh, that's That's wow. Chicken and the egg thing, isn't that dualism? We escape dualism by seeing it, they arose simultaneously in one moment. Past and future, the notion of past and future, is a compound, two-sided notion. It's not a one-sided notion. You cannot think about time as one-sidedness, so to speak, or just one, without any sides. You cannot. You have to think of it as two-sided. Like a coin has two sides simultaneously, right? It's not just, oh, there's one side. Oh, there's another side. Which side came first, you know? Chicken or the egg, which came first? Simultaneously. Past or future, which came first? Simultaneously. So this is no little insight. This is a huge insight, and we know it. But how do we handle huge insights? Well, we've been practicing. This is absolutely massive, colossal insight. Absolutely mountainous, a mountain of gold. We've been practicing that. So you say, yeah, this is a mountain of gold. That's great, I'm elated, I cheer it, I applaud it, I laud it. I'm jubilant, I'm ecstatic, I'm euphoric. This is wonderful. But I'm still sitting here, you know, in the mood of repentance, calmly sitting. And we don't try to extrapolate how we're going to feel and function in quote-unquote the future so much. We just stay right now how we feel right now, moment by moment. Don't let the mind say, wow, what am I going to do when I'm enlightened or something? No, don't let that happen. I am just a humble, serious, repentant mind, spirit, with a severe continuity problem. That's all I am at this moment. So I'm just staying within the moment. Stay within the moment of how, of the mood of repentance right now. I have a very severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have, but it's very severe. Now, to shift a little bit here, to actually lighten it up a little bit, although it may seem we're going heavier, it's actually something we're more used to. The world and how the world is behaving. The world is behaving very badly right now because it is trying to intensify its imagining of what if we weren't free? You know, what if we were not free? How would that be? And they want to play that out intensely now. Now, if I was functioning as a spiritual consultant to the world, I would very easily say that everyone has an extraordinarily severe continuity problem. And that problem is so detrimental to everyone that we really don't have time or attention to focus on much of anything else. We have to look in the mirror and say, you know what? I am not going to spend any energy criticizing someone else. I'm not going to spend any time trying to attack someone else, run them down, criticize, you know. I'm not going to do that. I have to, my own problem is so severe, I have to spend my attention working on my problem. I got no choice in this, really. Now, those who spend their time trying to, looking for scapegoats and saying, you're the one, you're the bad one, they're behaving in an extraordinarily extravagant, whimsical fashion, actually, because they're pretending, they're saying, well, I don't have a continuity problem. Oh, yes, they do. They have an extreme continuity problem. They can't imagine not imagining. You know, they can't imagine not imagining that the next moment that the future is determined by the past. They can't imagine not imagining that. And that means they have a gigantic, severe continuity problem because it's not happening. But they believe is happening isn't happening. And they have no choice but to realize that at some point. So we have to, you know, recognize there's never been any time. And that's like, whoa, wait a minute. You mean there's never been any scripts? No scripts. There are no scripts. It's like, what? Jesus says the script is written. I interpret that actually as meaning that the script, the fact is there are no scripts. And that is true. And that means there's this massive continuity problem. So the Holy Spirit does its own sequencing of moments to help set us down into a soft landing into the recognition of timelessness. So it may be that the Holy Spirit seems to have a script working off of our belief in a script, you see, working with beliefs, healing belief. So there's a belief in a script, but there aren't any scripts actually. Reality is totally unscripted, totally free. And this is reality. Everything's reality. It's always reality. It is always reality. So I would say to everyone, as a spiritual consultant, to the planet, is saying everyone needs to focus on their own problem, the continuity problem. So take a break from criticizing anyone. What's the number one tenet of many great teachings? Forgiveness. Forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. Meaning, okay, you know, someone did something you don't like. You say, look, I don't have the quote-unquote time and energy for me to try and solve your continuity problem. I've got a severe continuity problem that's so terrible. I've got to work on myself. So I'm not going to criticize you. I'm not going to try to straighten you out. I'm just going to say, hey, you know, I got to straighten myself out. I'm really have this gigantically severe continuity problem, and I have to do what is best for that. Imagine if everyone in the world was like that, how peaceful the world would be. Because we would acknowledge in one another that, yes, I have a severe chronic problem. I know you do too. I know we're working on it. And so we can certainly, from that standpoint, there's a meeting of the minds and hearts. And there's forgiveness all around. It's so easy to let stuff go, right? There's so many instances in life, right, where we say, you know what, I just need to let that go because it's not right. I cannot afford to pursue that because my own problem is so severe. It's really a blessing to be aware of the severity of your continuity problem, because then you don't go try and pursue all this stuff. Somebody cuts you off driving crazily, like, no, forget it. You don't take action against others. You say, I have to focus on myself and my problem. It's like, let's say you have a rotting tooth, a toothache, and it's just like so incredibly problematic. You can't even think of anything else. Well, look, if somebody is tailgating you or cuts you off or does something driving, you're going to the dentist, you don't care. You say, whatever, you know, I can't afford to stop and yell at you or anything. I got to get to the dentist right now. It's like that. We all have this terrible toothache, and we have to get to the dentist on time. And we cannot afford the extravagance of pounding our chests and yelling at somebody, yelling at people. We got this extraordinarily ruinous type of issue in our lives, the continuity problem of believing in time. For so long, for so many moments, we can't even imagine not imagining time. We cannot even imagine it. That's how bad it is. So Jesus said, turn the other cheek, love your enemy, forgive your neighbor, your trespasses, as they forgive your trespasses against you. Forgive all the trespasses, forgive one another, turn the other cheek. Why? Because we have to keep our focus on our own, the continuity problem, and this maddening issue of time that doesn't exist, that only arises. It's like the idea of two moments joined, that arises within one moment, right? Not two moments. And even those who spend this, put all their focus on this, it can take a lifetime to accept this fact. Hopefully a little sooner, a little quicker than that, maybe half a lifetime. I know I've been at it intensely for 36 years. Intensely. Very intensely. Really my entire life, but I think it was the summer of 1978. Very auspicious time, 1978, for some reason. That's when everything for me had this just incredible string of awakenings in 1978, starting in the summer of 78, going through into the January of 79, I believe. Yeah. And I came across A Course in Miracles in 1978, the summer of 1978. So that's when it all started. And I just had this symbol, I woke up, had a moment of, I saw duality for what it was. And then I realized I was going to fall back into struggling with it in a time-based way. And I said, well, I know I can get back to this realization. Had many experiences, just amazing. So there's been 36 years of intensity, which seems like a lot. But the continuity problem, I say it's very severe. It's not a joke. It really has enormous fear with it, because we are imagining excuse me, we're trying to imagine a new identity for ourselves. We're trying to create a new identity for ourselves. And so in doing so, we have got to the point where we feel that imagining a new identity for ourselves is the new identity. And if we stop imagining time, we won't have any identity. So the fear is that we'll lose our identity. And so that's an enormous fear. And it's not true, but we're so afraid of it, we defend against this in so many ways that we in order to not recognize duality is the idea of two past and future arising in just one moment. And then we realize the past has never been determining the future, and so there's never been any time, and therefore we're only imagining just this one moment over and over, so there isn't any process taking place, so there isn't any process-based identity. There never will be, and that's when the fear arises. So when I woke up in 1978, I know that seems like, lifetimes ago, actually. I saw it, I said, oh, okay, I see it, and I said, I'm starting to forget it already. And I said, oh my gosh. And then I consciously forgot it. I realized I was sinking down into forgetfulness, but I remained aware that I was sinking down into forgetfulness. And then I kept that awareness, and then I said, all I have to do is find the right teachings, the right teacher, and make the right effort to eventually, I will clear this up. And then I will be awake to this and experience the inherent intrinsic happiness, unalloyed happiness, not based on process, not based on time, not based on imagination. Totally steady happiness, it will be there. So, the path can be very difficult. So we're trying to make it easier here by normalizing spending time patiently going over this stuff, realizing that we're very shaky about it because we think our identity may be at stake. We just imagined a new identity. What if we had a new identity that was based on a causation of time, of moments determining others? What kind of identity would that be like? But it's just imaginary. It's not real. It's not there. It's a mirage. And the identity is really just the belief that the next moment is automatically being chosen automatically by the past moment. You know, it's everything's on autopilot. So we feel that we're the creator. Our creator is just an autopilot thing, and we're on autopilot, and it's all just happening that way. It's not true. No, it's not that way. It seems that way to us. So we say, if I'm not on autopilot, I might not exist. No, the happiness of freedom will automatically be there. Even if we choose the next moment to be the same as the previous one, or very similar, we can just continue that, it's not a problem. But the happiness will be there. And we'll be aware of the happiness. So we say, well, I don't have an identity. Well, happiness is our identity, really. We can say, I have an identity as happiness. Because that's everyone's identity. That is the identity. That is the shared identity. Is this peace, love, freedom, light, happiness? That is inherent inherent as what we truly are. It cannot not be there. It has to be there. So when we let go of this, all our thoughts, we relax our mind, release our thoughts, and let them go. What will be experienced is this happiness. And our fear is what we try to say, well, where's the past of this, and where's the future of this, and where's the process of it? And there isn't any process in it. There's no past and there's no future. And then we say, well, how can we... That's our concern. We say, well, where's the identity then? How can I have this? How can this be part of my identity? Well, it's not part of our identity. It is our identity. In other words, we say, well, how can I have this determine my future? No, it is the indeterminate, undefined future. It is the undefinedness of what we are. The future moments are not defined for us. As Sri Nisargadatta says, what I am is undefined, is not defined by anything, not defined by any appearance, not defined by any moment that I choose. Because what we really are is freedom. Again, don't try to figure this out discursively, linearly, analytically, intellectually, academically. Because there aren't any parts to our happiness. There is no story to our happiness. There is no concepts fitting together to form our happiness. It's unformed. It's free-floating happiness. Unformed, free-floating happiness. Now, as we are trying to establish this separate identity, our free-floating happiness seems to be a massive threat to us. And that's where we get this free-floating anxiety. Because now it seems to be the boogeyman. It seems to be what threatens our identity. And we can't get a handle on it. It's free-floating. That's actually our happiness. But with us feeling threatened by it, thinking that this is a threat to us, it's a threat to time, a threat to our identity, a threat to process. So that's why we have such a difficult time treating this free-floating anxiety. It's really our true nature, it's our true happiness, which is undetermined, has no story, is not defined by any appearance, anything that ever happens. It's totally undefined. It just is. So it seems to us to just be, we can't get a handle on it. It's free floating. And this perspective of the ego here in this world, they reach a point at some point where we suddenly feel like this anxiety, and terrible free-floating anxiety, like we don't know what to do about it. And people say, well, you know, you're afraid of this, afraid of that, and they don't understand what's going on. It's actually our true identity that is frightening us. When we presume that we're this false identity, then we feel threatened by the true one. And so we try to put this happiness into forms so we don't feel so threatened by it, so it feels defined and based on time, so we see it in another person, a relationship, a experience, a thing, a career, a life, whatever. We try to project it onto that, but it never works, does it? Because the anxiety is still there. We keep thinking, you know what, I just want to let go of this. I want to let go of everything. And I say, oh my God, if I let go of everything, I'll be so unhappy. I'll have this, total anxiety. So our socialization is a defense against truth, actually. And it strives to limit this anxiety. Instead of saying, you know what, we could give up duality, this dualistic notion, we could see duality for what it is, and then we wouldn't feel threatened by our happiness. But I'll tell you this, our happiness isn't going anywhere. So we can spend, untold, quote-unquote, billions of years trying to defend against this anxiety, and we have not done anything to diminish it in the slightest bit, really. It's still entirely there. Our happiness, the happiness of our perfect freedom is still there. And we'll really be scratching our heads. And we may try to put the happiness into winning some game, winning some competition, winning some relationship, winning some argument. And for a while we think, oh yeah, I'm happy because I won this. And then it starts to wear off and you say, wow, wait a minute. I still feel this anxiety, which is this, again, unalloyed, perfect happiness, which is not affected by anything whatsoever. It's our intrinsic nature. It's still there. Intrinsic nature is still there. And we say, I gotta win better. I gotta win better. I'm to the point now, I don't want the Giants to lose any game fight. If they lose, I get so upset. I just say, I want a constant winner. Only a constant winner will do. And so this just shows that the happiness is always present. So there's no way that we can grasp anything of this world and do away with this anxiety. Only accepting everything as a winner right now. Everything is winning. Because it's all, there is no script. You see, everything is free. My experiencing is free. And as a matter of fact, everything is eternal. Because I can imagine it exactly the same way that it is now, forever, if I wanted to. Or I could see it differently, and then I could go back to it the way that it is now. Everything is eternal. Everything is eternally free. And so that way we can be at peace with our happiness. It's our happiness that is tormenting us, actually. It's not really our fear. We're afraid of our happiness. Because it seems to threaten our imaginary identity, our imaginary time-based identity. This day has to set records for heat. It's got to be setting records, I'm telling you. I don't ever remember an April day like this. This is like sizzling. even took the cat inside. I said, it's too hot for you out here, but he insisted on coming back out, of course. And you see, we don't have to arrive at any conclusion, do we? Not now. This stuff's beyond that. It's amazing, is what it is. This is amazing. So when you're experiencing amazement, you just it's a hang with it situation. It's a big league hang with it situation. Would they like foul a ball off their foot or their shin or something, you know? They can't say, oh, Nucky, what happened? He threw a pitch, I swung, I hit it off my shin or whatever. No, they just have to hang with it, you know? It's like, wow, this is amazing. I just hit a ball off my shin. It's like, I'm feeling like, you know, an endorphin rush or something. Like, wow, just got to hop around and hang with it. So we're just hopping around and hanging with it, but in a positive way. When you hit a grand slam to win a game, you realize you just got to run around the bases and touch home plate, and everybody's going to mob you. You know, everybody's going to be dousing you with water, and you just say, "Wow, okay, here it goes. I just have to just keep going. Got to run around the bases. I know the celebration is waiting. Got no choice. So like this. So I know the celebration is waiting for me. You know, I know." So, but I'm just saying, okay, you know, I just have to keep going here. Just put one foot in front of the other. That's all. Just keep putting one foot in front of the other. We'll leave the celebration till, you know, when it happens, that kind of situation, right? That's our attitude. When it comes, don't count your chickens before they're hatched. Ah, what's today? Today, Wednesday. Oh my gosh, the gardeners are, I think they've just arrived. God. That might be a good time to stop the video. Because they're gonna break out their noisemakers. Maybe that's part of the celebration. Don't really want to end the video though, because this is so fruitful. Any time, quote unquote time, that we're able to just look at the whole issue of time. That is time very well spent. Those are moments very well spent. Instead of asking about other stuff. It's possible to ask questions about all sorts of stuff, actually. Endless questions. But when you get down to actually looking at the issue of time and no time, you can be sure that you're engaged in a tremendously fruitful endeavor. You can be sure of it. The other stuff, very iffy. It's possible. So if your intent is there and the effort's there, it's possible. But when you're able to actually put your intent and attention on this issue of timelessness, it's bound to be fruitful. But the ego tells us that it's too difficult for us. Of course, what's the ego going to say? That's what it's going to say. It says, you know what? That's for the big boys, big girls. You can't do that. It's too difficult. That's for Jesus. That's for so-and-so. You can't get that. That's really high, heavy stuff. You can't do that. And you say, okay, I better work. You know, we've got to work up to that. I need a lot of time in order to realize that there is no time. But we don't really Not really. It seems that way because of the continuity issue. It only seems that way because of the continuity issue. But the ego just wants us to keep stringing more and more moments together so that we believe more and more that we, in time, that we say, I can't imagine not imagining this way, so therefore it must be joined. Each moment must, the past must be determining the future, because it, just look at all history, look back, I don't see anything but that, so it must be true. We say, well, it must be true. And then we say, well, it's absolute insanity then to even question this. So the ego tries to prevent us from doing this. But if we're doing it, that means its curtains are the ego. So the path is really a question of gathering your nerve and focusing it where it needs to be focused, is to do the best you can with the nerve that you have, and then getting some rest. And then coming back, gathering your nerve again, and doing it again. And that's it. I mean, that is the path. That is the way. Putting one foot in front of the other. Trying to keep your stride. Keep your stride. Try to keep it smooth. Try to keep your stride going. Don't push so hard that you just say, well, I need to take a week off. This is too much. You have to keep the stride going. So you try to recover as quickly as possible. And in the meantime, when you're not really focused like this intensely, try to keep some saying going, like, I stand with I am. I stand with I am. Some sort of saying that you can focus on. Because the answer is here. There's no question. We're looking straight at the answer here. Because of the continuity issue, we're smart. And we say, okay, I see the answer. It's right there. Okay, let me just sit here. Don't let me try to grasp it, get a hold of it, put it in a bottle. And the ego wants us to tell it how about this happiness, this unalloyed, uncaused, process-free, traceless, baseless happiness that we have. He says, well, how did you get that? Or how was the process? It always asks, what is the process? Why? So it can interfere, quote unquote, interfere with the process. So it can duplicate it, so it can put it into time. It's insisting that it's in time, right? So it's saying, what is the process of this happiness? And say, there is none. Well, no, what came before it? How did it arise or something? No, it's always been there. How come you didn't experience it before? Because I was trying to imagine that it, what if it didn't arise? That's all. The ego's very clever. It wants, the Holy Spirit is, gives us pure happiness because of space and time, the belief system. It works with our belief systems, able to present it to us. So the Holy Spirit's the distributor of this pure, unalloyed happiness. And the ego wants you to be a distributor. Instead of just a client. Say, no, I'm just a client, I'm not a distributor. It wants you to be a distributor. Because it doesn't want to ask the Holy Spirit. See, it was afraid. People are afraid to ask the Holy Spirit because they know the Holy Spirit will give it to them if they ask. So they want to ask someone else other than that. And they want to know about process. Well, what's the process here of this happiness? What's going on? What's the physics of it? No physics of it. And the cleverness of the ego can be noticed. Don't fight it, just notice it. Quietly, calmly, witness it, notice it, observe it. Don't say anything to it. Don't react to it. Don't let it cause you to fall asleep or amp you up. Just stay steady. And in the noticing of it, it evaporates. That's the one thing the ego can't stand, is you just quietly noticing what it's doing. It wants you to argue with it, dispute with it, throw remedies at it, do this, this, and that. Time-based, right? But you say, no, I'm recognizing there is no time. Time is a dualistic concept arising in the moment, each moment. It's not actually linking one moment to the other. It's not outside of a moment. There's nothing outside of a moment. The moment, each moment is everywhere. There's nothing outside of each moment. So it's not like there's the past is in one moment and the future is in another moment. You know, the past and the future is one two-sided concept arising in each moment, completely contained in a moment. And at some point this will dawn upon us. And the ego wants to say, well, wait, which came first, chicken or the egg? Chicken and egg you, right? Where's the process? Which is first? No, don't answer. And the ego says it's speaking for your new identity. There is no new identity. It's not speaking for anything. It's speaking for the continuity fear, is what it's really speaking of. So label it that way. Say, no, I only have a continuity problem. That's the only problem that's speaking to me. I don't have any other problem speaking to me. It's really important to do that. If you want to save yourself immense suffering, that's the way to do it, is the continuity practice. I don't have a which chicken and egg problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. It's the only problem that's speaking to me. I don't have any other problem. The chicken and the egg problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. This is how you keep the ego off your back, is the continuity practice. I don't have, whatever the ego is trying to tell you, I don't have a argument problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a fear problem, I have a continuity problem. Whatever problem you can imagine, say, I don't have that problem, I only have a continuity problem. And that's how to get the ego will back off then, because it's speaking for time and presumed identity, and we know there isn't any, which means we have a continuity problem. We don't have a time problem, we have a continuity problem. And the ego, therefore, cannot speak for the continuity problem. Only the Holy Spirit can speak for it, which means only the vision of oneness has value. The ego only speaks for time, the concept of time. It cannot speak for timelessness. Ego is just our fear of happiness, actually. The ego can't be happiness, it's our fear of happiness. When our fear of happiness is gone, the ego's gone. The ego's not a thing, it's just a fear, it's a continuity fear. And we try and place the continuity fear as some into time, as it were, into the future, into situations, you know, instead of right here. Continuity, I have a continuity problem, means the answer's right here. It's just that I'm afraid to accept it, that's what it means. It's like I'm standing where I need to be. I'm already where I need to be. I'm just afraid to open my eyes. That's what it means. It means we don't have to go anywhere. We don't have to do is our problem. We don't have any of those problems. We only have a continuity problem. Nothing else. vision of oneness resolves that continuity problem. Okay. So the hardened arrows are starting in on their work, and just as the world is, you know, starting getting very intense with trying to defend against our innate happiness, trying to create a identity based on failure, some permanent failure identity, permanent unfreedom, is getting very intense, and yet we are able to complete this consideration of time, in time, so that we're able to accept the holy instant, the one moment of time the Holy Spirit presents to us. And we don't need to struggle with the explanations I've gone over many times, I will again many times. It's enough to just look at this issue of time, timelessness. Just look at it as we have. And our fear is much, much less than it was before. Much less. And so results are bound to come from fruits are bound to form from this. Always, when we look at this time, fruits are ripening very fast. Okay, that's we'll wrap this video up. Thanks for watching. That's it.